Brother Ted Fellows will be preaching next Friday night, wrote that song, wrote that verse years ago. And that's the position we've always taken. You know, it's interesting. You can tell a lot about a ministry based on the Bible version it's using, especially in our day. Ministries that have always been considered fundamental kind of ministries, a lot of has swapped over to the ESV, the English Standard Version. And the fascinating thing about that is that the English Standard Version is really a revision of the Revised Standard Version, which was produced by the National Council of Churches in 1952 and was denounced by every conservative outfit in the country because it was produced by the liberal National Council of Churches, modernists. And yet now you have the conservative fundamentalist so-called endorsing a translation that's a revision of the National Council of Churches. Every time you buy an ESV, you put money in the coffers of the National Council of Churches. They hold the copyright to the RSV. And you see that and you think, how are the mighty fallen? And you know, it's a complete lack of understanding about what the Bible is. And I don't make any bones about it. I understand our ministry is not appreciated in a lot of places because of our stand for the King James Bible. And that's okay. I don't mind that. And if you do, then that's up to you. But someone was asking me the other day, said, you know, there are these grace outfits and they have all these ministries that they're linked to and stuff. And they always, how many of them leave you out? I said, they're not leaving us out. They're leaving out the King James Bible. And that's a sad thing. When you don't have God's word in your language, then you need to seek God's word in your language and the language that you speak. And anyway, I get off on that, and then I won't preach what I'm going to talk about. But next Friday night, I want to invite you Friday night, Saturday night, come to the meetings and enjoy. Brother Ted Fellows, he was in the original Grace School of Bible class. He's an old guy like me. Not as old as me, but he's one of the older brothers. And Brother John Verstegen, Saturday night, will be preaching. John was the first one of our extension ministry students. Sunday morning, Pastor Curtis will be teaching the first session. My son Rick will be preaching the second session. And Brother Carl Coates from the Netherlands. Carl is originally from South Africa. He married a girl in the Netherlands and lives there now and has ministry there. He'll be preaching on Sunday night. Will be interesting to see what language he preaches in. He does speak English well enough. You know how Dez speaks? It's sort of an English, and you understand about, 75% of it. Well, Carl's the same way, except he's got the Netherlands stuck in there with it. So, it'll be interesting to see how he does. But you'll enjoy Carl. He's a great guy, and appreciate his ministry. He joins us every month on the Zoom study. So some of you know him. But we'll have a great time. If you want to help, with the weekend, Carl, Alex told you, my wife and I, the past week, we've been to Costco, we've been to Sam's, we've been to Gordon Food, we're going to the caterer. I mean, this has been, if you see stuff stacked all over the building, that's for the supplies we're gathering together for the weekend. And if you can help with the desserts and that kind of stuff, you see Cynthia, ask, she can kind of give you an idea of what you need. If you want to help with the housing, you see Debbie, if you'd like to have some of these men stay in your homes, the pastors and the wives will be here. And if you'd like to help with that, if you'd like to help financially with the expenses, you can either give it directly to Grace School of the Bible or put it in the church ministry and just designate it for that. But be sure that you designate anything you do for the conference so that the brothers know how to conduct that. Anyway, next Sunday, We'll have the meetings. We won't disrupt everything too bad. And next Sunday, by the way, you'd be welcome to stay for lunch after the morning meeting. So we'll have the fellowship, and then the brothers will be, most of them will be going home in the afternoon. So anyway, we're looking forward to a great time next weekend. Appreciate your prayers and your interest for that. We've done this every year for about 30 years, and it's always a great time, a fellowship. Every year since we've been in this building, it's rained. This coming weekend is supposed to rain all weekend. So it's sort of like normal. Here we are, dry folks, getting the water. But it sprinkles. It doesn't usually pour. So you're more Methodist than a Presbyterian. And we hope not to be like a Baptist where you're going to drown. So we'll do the best we can. Have a good time. Romans chapter number 6. I want to look at verse number 11 to 14 with you this morning in a little bit of detail. This is the most important passage in Paul's epistles, about experiencing the life that you have in Christ. You know, you teach doctrine. You teach the doctrine. Doctrine of proof, correction, instruction in righteousness, that the man of God might be through, that you might have maturity in your life, that you might live and grow up and function as a believer, that what you know would live in the details of your life. How often it is we know stuff, we get the doctrine, and yet it doesn't translate itself over into our experience. Well, this is the passage that deals with that issue specifically. It starts in chapter 5. Romans, you can divide Romans up into sections. The first, years ago, I was about 18 years old. That's so many years ago, I can't remember how many that is. I read a commentary on Romans written by Donald Gray Barnhouse. You won't know who he was, but he was a Bible teacher back in the 50s, 40s and the 50s and the 60s. And he talked about Romans, the first three chapters, down to verse 20, this man's ruin. Then he talked about chapter 3 and 4, that's God's remedy. Then he called chapter 5 God's rivers. And I've always remembered that because in Romans 5, all the things that God did to remedy our ruin and sin, the flow of that, what flows out of God, of the redemption that's in Christ Jesus, chapter 5 talks about. And chapter 5 is really a transition between all God's done to satisfy and rescue us from our sins, plural, into the discussion he has in chapter 6, 7, and 8 about how God has delivered us from our sin. Now, the difference between sin and sins are the symptom, the things we do. Sin is the source, the core origin of why we do what we do. And in Bible teachers, they call sin your sin nature. That is the core that causes you. Think of a fruit bearing. If you're a peach tree, why do you only have peaches? Because that's the nature. That's who you are, and who you are, you produce fruit. The fruit that you produce, good, bad, indifferent, whatever it is always going to be peach at whatever the degree of it is. But it's always going to be the core of who you are. So what Romans 6, 7, and 8 does is talks about here's the core of who you are and why you can produce fruit unto God. In chapter 5, he starts out, verse number 1, therefore being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom also we have access by faith into this grace when we stand, and rejoice in hope of the glory of God. There's all three phases of your Christian life. That's what chapter 1, 2, 3, and 4 has produced for you. Therefore, having the reality of being justified by faith. Justification is the issue in chapter 3 and 4. Justification, and it's by faith, chapter 4. That being true, you have peace with God. You also, verse number 2, by whom also we have access by faith into this grace when we stand. One is justification. It's over with. It's done. I have God's righteousness. But I also have access to this grace as I walk through life. And then I'm rejoicing in hope the future. So you have past, present, and future. Everything's provided for you. Then in verse 3, and not only so, but we also glory in tribulation also. Now that's an interesting verse. You not only have this past, present, and future salvation that's complete and total, justification, sanctification, glorification, you have a present reality that all that allows you to rejoice in trouble. Whoa. Now there's a need for trouble in your life. And that's what he's going to get into here. You don't just rejoice in trouble, you need the trouble. Why is that? Also, knowing that tribulation, trouble, difficulty, pressure, whatever it is, whether it's your failures or it's just things that come on you, tribulation works. Patience. Now, when it works, tribulation takes, here's your experience. You're experiencing tribulation. And it works something in your life that produces patience. Patience produces experience, and experience produces hope. And hope makes not ashamed because the love of God shed abroad in our hearts. You have a progression of growing. Tribulation, trouble, difficulty produces. The Word of God works in you, the reality of your justification, the reality of God working in your life, the reality of your hope in Christ. When you think like God thinks about you, it works. The Word of God works in you that believe, and it works patience. the capacity to stick with what God's Word says and not abandon it. Patience produces experience. Now you've got some skill in handling problems. And that tells you that there's a hope, there's something in the future out there that God's going to... So all of a sudden, our experience, see, he's taking the identity of that you have and putting it into your experience. And the necessary ingredient there is the trouble. And then he talks about the love of God for you in verse 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. Then in verse number 12, he changes the topic from your sins, the things that happen that you do, to your sin. Where does all this, where does all this stuff actually come from? Verse 12, wherefore by one man sin entered into the world. That one man is Adam. Sin entered into the world, and death by sin. So that death passed upon all men, for that all have sinned. So now you have death passing upon everybody because we all came from Adam. Verse 14, nevertheless, death reigned from Adam to Moses, even over them that had not sinned after the similitude of Adam's transgression, who was a figure of him that was to come. So there's a source of our sin is because we're kin to Adam. Adam is the head of the race, head of humanity. When Adam sinned, all of humanity sinned in him because he's all that humanity was. And then he began to have kids, and he passed on to his children, his descendants, that's you and me, his nature, the nature of sin. He's a picture of the Lord Jesus Christ in that sense, a figure of him that's to come. When you're in Christ, just like in Adam, all sinned. Everybody that's in Adam inherited everything that Adam had. In Christ, you're made alive. Everyone that's in him shares everything that belongs to him. So that's why you come to chapter 6 in verse number 3. Or verse number 1. What shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? God forbid. How shall we that are dead to sin live any longer therein? Now how in the world did you get to be dead, not in sin, but to sin? How did you die in relationship to sin? Knowing... Know you not. Verse 3. You got to know something. That as many of us as were baptized into Jesus Christ were baptized into his death. Therefore being buried with him by baptism into death, that like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life. For if we were planted together in the likeness of his death, we should also be in the likeness of his resurrection. You and I were made one with Christ. When you trusted the Lord Jesus Christ, something that God did for you, you didn't feel it, you didn't sense it, you wouldn't know it if you didn't read it in the Word of God. But when you read it in the Bible, he says, by one Spirit are we all baptized into one body, the body of Christ. God took you and placed you in a complete identification with his Son. When Jesus Christ died, his death was your death. Just like when Adam sinned, that's where you got yours from. In Christ, everything belongs to him now belongs to you. And that's the wonderful truth of our identification in the Lord Jesus Christ. You need to know that. You need to understand that. Your identity, and we call that positional truth. And the reason we call it positional truth is because that little word in. I know there's some people don't like to identify positional truth. If you're in Adam, that's your position. If you're in Christ, that's your position. In Adam, in that position, you have an identity. You got an old man. In Christ, you have an identity. You got a new man. The issue of identification has to do with where are you? You're in Adam, you're in Christ. And when you're in Christ, you have a new... You see what it said in verse number 4? That we should walk in newness of life. There's an oldness, there's a newness. You have a new life. Now, you need to know that. If you don't know that, it can't be a reality in your life. You can't believe something you don't know. Now, you guys, if you sit in this room for any length of time, you should understand these things because we talk about them all the time. That's why we talk about the baptism in verse 6 in verse 3 is not water baptism. Every time you see someone teaching water baptism, they are hiding, they're covering up, they're diminishing the ability for you to understand the real true identity. Water baptism is designed in religion to give you an identity to that whatever that religion is. If you're a Methodist, you sprinkle. If you're a Presbyterian, you pour. If you're a Baptist, you dunk them. And that's all they want to talk about. And that's how you become a Methodist, Presbyterian, or Baptist, or any of the groups that are involved in those kind of things. Because baptism in the Bible has to do with identity. But this is not a water. No water ceremony puts you into Jesus Christ. That's a spiritual thing, not a physical thing. 1 Corinthians 12, verse 13, Colossians 2, verse 12. It's the operation of God the Holy Ghost. And literally, when he takes you out of your identity in Adam and puts you into a new identity in Christ, everything changed spiritually. In God's mind, everything changed. Now, the key to that is to know how God thinks about you. And then to think the same way. That's the challenge. That's how you bring it out of theology, doctrine, knowledge, into experience. Look down at verse number. Well, let's keep reading. Verse 6. Knowing this, you've got to know something. That our old man is crucified with him, that the body of sin might be destroyed. That henceforth we should not serve sin. For he that is dead is freed from sin. Now, if we be dead with Christ, we believe that we shall also live with him, knowing that Christ, being raised from the dead, dieth no more. Death hath no more dominion over him. For in that he died unto sin once, but in that he liveth unto God. So that's the key. That's the doctrine. That's the truth. Verse number 11, likewise, because all that's true, reckon yourselves to be dead indeed unto sin, but alive unto God. In other words, believe it. When you reckon something, you say, this is what the accounting says is true. Believe what, don't just know it. If you don't know it, you can't believe it. But if you know it and you don't believe it, it doesn't come into your experience. The way you bring that knowledge into the details of your life where it transforms the conduct of your life is by believing it. Verse 11, likewise reckon ye. You see the word reckon? That's an imperative. That's a command. Verse 12, let not sin therefore. That's a command. Let not sin. There's a command to believe something, and there's a command to obey something. Obey what you believe. Obey the doctrine. There's a learning. There's a believing. There's an obedience of faith. And it's that obedience of faith, the Word of God works effectually in you, that believe. Folks, there are things that are true of you in Christ that you will never experience in the details of your life until you believe that they are actual, literal, absolute, current realities of your perfect place in Him. When you recognize who He's made you and you reject as unworthy of your present real character, your old man and all that he produces. These verses 11 through 14 are how to do that. So I'm going to start in verse number. Well, let's read them. Verse 11. Likewise, reckon ye also yourselves to be dead indeed unto sin, but alive unto God through Jesus. Believe this. Let not sin, therefore, because you believe verse 11 is true, let not conduct yourself this way. Let not sin, therefore, reign in your mortal bodies, that you should obey it in the lust thereof. Neither yield ye your members, parts of your body, as instruments of unrighteousness unto sin, but yield yourselves unto God as those that are alive from the dead, and your members as instruments of righteousness unto God. For, you see that word for, I've talked to you about that many times. When you see that word for in a start of verse, he's telling you, let me explain to you what I just said to you, how it happens. For sin shall not have dominion over you. That's what verse 11, 12, and 13 are about. How does sin not have dominion over you? By obeying those verses. For you are not under the law, you're under grace. So if you start with verse 14, he explains to you how verse 11, 12, and 13 operate. Sin doesn't have dominion over you. That's what they're talking about. It doesn't reign in your mortal bodies. You don't yield your members to it. You yield your members to righteousness, to the real identity you have in Christ. Well, how do you do that? For you're not under the law, but you're under grace. Now, when he talks about being under the law is a performance-based system of acceptance. You go about, chapter 10, he talks about Israel, they go about to establish their own righteousness. When you're under the law, whether it's God's law, the Ten Commandments, whether it's man's law, whether it's the church's law, whatever it is, it's always a performance-based acceptance program. When you're going to find your acceptance before God based on your performance, I'm going to do this, God's going to love me. I'm going to do this, God's going to accept me. I'm going to do this, I'm going to be serving. That's law. And it doesn't work. All the law does is give sin, your failure, dominion over you. Sin should not have dominion over you. For you're not under the law. You're not under performance, but you're under grace. You have to get beyond law thinking. You have to get beyond thinking it depends on me doing it my way, the way I configured it. Look over at chapter 7. That's why in Romans chapter 7, the whole issue is Paul explaining what happens to a believer when they put themselves under a performance-based acceptance program. Chapter 4, Romans chapter 7, verse number 4. Wherefore, my brethren, ye also become dead to the law by the body of Christ. Why? That you should be married to another, even to him who is raised from the dead, that you should bring forth fruit unto God. So how are you going to bring forth, how are you going to have a life that's fruitful in the things of God? By functioning not under the law, not under you performing, but performing in the newness of the identity God's given you in Christ. For when we were in the flesh, the motions of sin, which were by the law, did work in our members to bring forth fruit unto death. But now we are delivered from that, from the law, that being dead when we were held, that we should serve in newness of spirit and not in oldness of letter. You're no longer going to be defined by who you are in yourself. Now you're going to define yourself by who you are in Christ, and that's going to set you free to live that way. If you drop down to verse number 14, in the verses in between, I'm not going to read them all. We'll talk about them later. But what he does in verse 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, and 13 is he discovers that the law tells him to do something and he can't do it. Hello? You know? That's what you learn about yourself. Is I can't. The reason I can't perform to do it is because I keep failing. So what he does when you live under a performance, you're going to do it and be accepted in what you do. Verse 14, for we know that the law is spiritual, but I am carnal, sold under sin. Now tell me something. Is that verse true of Paul? People say, well, this is Paul before he got saved. Well, people say that haven't really read the chapter. Is Paul carnal, sold under sin as a believer? Are you? Well, what did chapter 6, verse 7 say? For he that is dead, you're dead in Christ, is what? Freed from sin. Then you're not sold under sin. Well, how did Paul come to the place where he thought of himself as though he was still a lost man? Because he's put himself under, I'm going to do it, a performance system. The law treats you like you're still lost. Grace treats you like you're the new person in Christ. And when you get the defeat that you suffer because you tried to do something you couldn't do to start with, brings you to this condition. Now, verse number 15, 16, 17, he describes what he means to be sold under sin. For what that which I do, I allow not. For what I would, that do I not. But what I hate, that I do. That do I. You ever been there? Wait, I don't know. You have. I know you have. If something, I know I shouldn't do it. I don't want to do it, but I'm doing it anyway. Whatever it is for you. Back over in chapter 6, when it talks about the body of sin, I talked to you about that last week. Y'all remember those definitions about what sin really is. And that body of sin, that's that corpus of, you have a special way that you've developed of sinning. Your personality, your habits have produced certain ways that you like to sin. There are other ways that people don't. I was in a home recently and they were having supper and they had wine at the table and they offered my wife and I wine. Well, we don't drink. I don't drink wine because I don't like it. It's not that I think it's sinful to drink it. I don't care for it. I was never brought up that way. So my habits are different from their habits. These folks were from Europe, and they were used to that just kind of being their water system and so forth. Drunkenness is wrong. Don't be drunk with wine. But it's not a sin to drink wine. And they said, oh, well, you think it's... I said, I didn't say anything about it being sinful. I said, I don't like it. Well, this is good stuff. I said, I don't care. Give me some Dr. Pepper. Ew, I don't like Dr. Pepper. Well, too bad for you. You don't have any good taste. But see, my taste, the body of my sin is like Dr. Pepper and not wine. The body of your sin is like wine and not Dr. Pepper. That's too bad for you. But you understand, we have this way of sinning that's peculiar to me. So the good that I would do, I don't. The evil that I don't want to do, I do. For if I do that which is, I would not, I consider the law that it is good. Now, then it is no more I that do it, but sin that dwelleth in me. Listen, we're no longer identified by sin. That isn't who I am. That's who I used to be. Now I'm identified in Christ. You see down in verse 23 where it gets you? But I see another law in my members, warring against the law of my mind, bringing me into captivity to the law of sin and death, which is in my members. Oh, wretched man that I am. You've been there. Miserable. Because you're looking at your conduct and you say, that isn't where I want to be. That's not who I am. I know that's unworthy of who I am in Christ. Who shall deliver me from the body of this death? Who's going to get me out of this? I thank God through Jesus Christ our Lord. I just need to remember who I really am in chapter 6. What he's done in 7 is he's not living like chapter 6 is true. I myself, with the mind, thinking process, remember that. With my mind, I myself serve the law of God. But with the flesh, the law of sin. There is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in. There's no wretched man that I am. There's no, this I don't want to do, I do. What I do, I don't. There's no more of that to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, putting your performance as the issue, but after the Spirit. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has made me free from the law of sin and death. I've crucified with Christ. I've been buried with him. I've been raised to walk in newness of life. That's the law. That's the operating principle of the Spirit of God. For what the law could not do, and that it was weak, how? Through the flesh. You see, the law is in agreement with your flesh. It's connection with you do it. And that doesn't work. Because you can't accomplish it. So it's not going to be what you do, it's what Christ does. Now that's why you come back to chapter 6. Here's how you do the thing that I... Chapter 7, verse number, I didn't read the verse. Verse 18. For I know that in me, that is in my flesh, dwelleth no good thing. For to will is present with me, but how to perform that which is good I find not. That how to perform, that's the question. Always is. I know some things. I know who I am in Christ. Who are you? You got to start there. You got to know the reality of your current identity. That's what verse 3, 4, and 5, 6, 7. You're baptized into Christ. You're baptized into his death. You're dead with him. You're crucified with him. The issue of sins, plural, and sin nature is settled. You're dead to sin. You've been delivered from it. Its power to work in your life has been severed. When it says you're dead to sin, in relationship to your sinning and your sin nature, it no longer has the power to control your life. Now, as a lost person, you didn't even have a thought about it not control. But now you've been set free from that dominion. You've been buried with him. when you bury, you don't bury live people. You bury people that are dead. At least you hope you do. You know, the guy says, somebody says, well, at your funeral, what do you hope people say about you? And the guy says, I hope somebody looks at me and says, hey, he's moving. You bury dead people. You're buried with him. That's a confirmation. You're putting away. The issue is settled. We buried him. He's dead and gone. Then you've been raised to walk in newness. You have a transformation of life in its place. Now, when you understand who you are, you're dead to sin, you're alive to God, to Christ. When he says in verse number 6, knowing this, that our old man is crucified with him, that the body of sin might be destroyed. Remember what we talked about last week, and if you weren't here last week, get the study. It's on the internet, it's in the bookstore. If you were here and you got your notes, think about those definitions about what Paul's talking about. When he talks about sin, talking about your old man, talking about the body of sin, those definitions are critical for you to understand what it means to be dead indeed to sin. Because the things you're dead to, you need to know what that is in relationship. When it talks about sin, again, sin singular is the core that produces the symptoms. Sins are the symptoms. Sins are the result of the sin. So if I'm going to stop the sins, I need to deal with the source of the sins. If I don't want a peach tree dropping peaches in my backyard, I need to cut down the peach tree. Not just go out and pull all the fruit off of it every spring. Excuse me. The real solution is change the tree. Sin is the core. And I tried to identify for you that last week what that is. You remember the verses? Look at Romans chapter 1 real quick. Isaiah 53, verse number 6, I think is the clearest definition of sin in the Bible. You can go to a dictionary and get 6 different definitions, a theology book and get 15 different definitions. Here's one that just identifies it, and you don't need the definition of 16 different Greek words. Isaiah 53, 6, all we like sheep have gone astray. As you do that, we've turned into our own way, and the Lord's laid on him the iniquity of Saul. The going astray and the iniquity is that we turned into our own way. We decided we're not going to do it God's way, we're going to do it our way. How many times have you heard me say the middle letter of the word sin is the problem? I'm going to do it my way. I know what I want to do. I know what's best. Well, that's Romans chapter 1, verse number 21. Romans chapter 1, Paul describes how the heathen got to be the way they are, how you got to be the way you are. Verse 21, because when they knew God, they glorified him not as God, neither were thankful, but became vain in their imaginations. When you're not going to let God tell you what the truth is, you're going to make up your own mind about what it is. It's vanity. It's emptiness. And professing themselves, they became vain in their imagination, and their foolish heart was darkened. Professing themselves to be wise, they became fools. The core issue of sin is, I know what is best. Professing themselves to be wise. That attitude, and sin is really starts in an attitude, a thinking process. We're wise. I'm wise. I know what's best. It's a know-it-all attitude. Now, you know yourself. I know me. And you look at life, and you make decisions, and you decide, I know what's best. And that's what Adam and Eve did. And that's where the sins come from, because that nature that produces the sins is that attitude of I know what's best. Now in verse number 6, when he talks about, go back to Romans 6, verse 6, knowing this, that our old man is crucified. Your old man, that's Adam. That's chapter 5. And what does it say? Is crucified with him. Your old man, dead with him, buried with him. He's not the issue anymore. He's gone. And he's been replaced by a new life. So your old man is crucified. He's not the issue anymore. Why was he crucified? That the body of sin might be destroyed. Now that issue of the body, and by the way, the old man, that's when Paul talks like down in verse 19, I speak after the manner of men because of the infirmity of your flesh. Chapter 8, we read the verse about that they walk after the flesh, doesn't mind the things of the flesh. The flesh, that's the vehicle that's connected to Adam, the part of you that's your flesh. That's this stuff here. That is in my flesh. In the part of me that's connected to Adam, there's nothing good. The thinking process, the desire process, it's all unworthy. It's not something to follow. Well, I've been crucified with Christ so that old man, all the influence that comes from Adam won't be in my life anymore. If you look at chapter 8, verse 13, for if we live after the flesh, ye shall die. But if you through the Spirit do mortify, watch, the deeds of the body, you shall live. There's some deeds associated with that. Look over at Galatians chapter number 5. Galatians 5:24. They that are Christ have crucified the flesh with the affections and lust. The part of you connected Adams has some affections, has some desires, has some deeds that it wants to perform. And you've been separated from that. Now those deeds, affections, and desires that it wants, that's what, when he talks about the body of sin. When he talks about the body, he's not talking about your physical body. He's talking about, you know, we talk about a body of water. You talk about a musician has a body of work. I was at Costco, my wife's shopping, and I've got a cart full of stuff, and I'm standing around waiting on her. And so naturally, I go over by the book section. And there's a famous author of mystery books, and I'm looking at it, and Dolly Parton and him wrote a book. I'm thinking, Dolly Parton? Now, he wrote a book with Bill Clinton years ago, and I quit reading him after that. And now Dolly Parton? I'm thinking, whoa, that's interesting. And I was almost tempted to spend the $10 to buy the book just to see what she had to say. But it was a story. It's not going to be her writing. You know, it's can't imagine what kind of story she would have inspired him to write. But the guy has a body of work. He's got a list of about 40 books that he wrote. That's his body of work. The body of sin is all these things that your propensity towards sin, your sin nature, produces. And that body of sin has been, your old man, your connection with Adam is crucified. That body, all those things that connection to Adam produces in your life is destroyed. And when it says it's destroyed, he's not talking about being annihilated. It's just put out of business. It's not in control anymore. Look with me over at Hebrews chapter 2. That word destroyed is used over here in a way that kind of helps. Different kind of context. Hebrews chapter 2, verse 14. For as much then as the children are partakers of flesh and blood, he also himself, that is Christ, likewise took part of the same, that through death he might destroy him that had the power of death, that is the devil, and deliver them who through fear of death were all the lifetime subject to bondage. Well, how do you destroy him that has the power of death? He doesn't annihilate Satan, but he puts him out of business. How? By putting death away and producing life out of death. You take the power away. The old, that body of sin no longer runs your life. It's no longer the source of your life. It's out of business. You've been radically changed, transformed into the current reality of your identity in Christ. Now go back to Romans 6 and look at verse 11. There are five things here. If you want to know how to, riding in this morning, I was listening to the radio, and after our program came on, there came on an ad for a substance abuse recovery program run by some church. And, you know, you go to 12-step programs, you go to all the, and you say, well, they got all these steps. Here's Paul's five steps. Not just a recovery, because who wants to go back to where you were? Here are the five steps where you move into the transformed newness of life. And there are five commands. And I'm just going to overview them today because we don't have time to go through them in that much detail. But this is the how-to that he says in chapter 7 he can't figure out in himself. The first thing in verse 11, likewise, reckon ye yourselves also to be dead indeed unto sin, but alive unto God. Believe it. You are commanded. It's not a suggestion. God commands you to believe, verse 3, 4, and 5, and 6. He says, believe, reckon. This is the reality. You also yourselves are dead indeed into sin. How did you become dead to sin? You're baptized into Jesus Christ, baptized into his death. You're buried with him by baptism into death. And you're alive unto God. How did you do that? You're raised with him to walk in newness of life. How did you become dead to sin, alive unto God? The reality is that's who you are in Christ. That is the current reality of your actual condition before God right now. All the excuses you make are just excuses. The reality is that's your life. And you are commanded to believe that. If you don't believe what he says there, if you don't believe who God's made you, nothing else makes any difference. You've been radically transformed in your inner man into the current reality of what these verses say you are. You're dead to sin, alive unto God. So believe it. Now when you believe that, verse number 12, let not sin therefore reign in your mortal bodies, that you should obey it in the lust thereof. You make a choice not to give your members to sin. I'm dead to sin. I'm alive unto God. So I'm not going to yield the parts of my body. I'm not going to yield my body. Let sin not therefore reign in your mortal body. That's the totality of who you are. You get to the parts later. I'm not going to let who I am be used for sin. That you should obey it. That's how you yield, is you obey. You yield yourself, the entirety of who you are, to say, I'm not going to yield my mortal body to sin. I'm not going to live in sin. I'm not going to live like I used to live. And when it talks about your mortal body, go back with me to Genesis chapter 2 just for a second. Genesis 2. There's a fascinating thing back here about Adam and Eve. Because when it talks about your mortal bodies, he's telling you something about how you operate. Alex put a chart on the wall this morning, and Alex is teaching a real important series on the Holy Spirit working in your life in the first hour. If you're not here, you're missing out. If you're missing out, get the studies. That's why we make video and audio and put it on the internet, because we know some folks aren't going to be here. But if you're slipping in or you're sipping coffee at the restaurant, whatever you're doing, shame on you. You're missing out. And he drew that diagram, and I said, I draw three circles, and by the time I'm finished, you can't read it. He's cleaned it up, made it nice. Irreducible complexity. You remember that phrase? That's a great phrase. I wrote that one down. That's irreducible complexity that you can read, okay? And it's important to understand how this stuff works, and that's what he's describing here. Genesis chapter 3, verse number 6. when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was pleasant to the eyes, and a tree to be desired to make one wise. So she sees it, and she recognizes that it's to be desired. Verse 7, they took it and ate. The eyes of them were opened, and they knew that they were naked. And they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves aprons. The instant that they knew they were naked, they became aware of some things that had happened in their life. By the way, they weren't naked prior to that. They had a clothing. Man was the only creature God created that he didn't give their own clothes. Animals have their own clothing. He created man, and he gave man his clothing. The original coat of many colors God gave to Adam and Eve to wear. So that when the Lord walked with them in the cool of the day, all of creation saw the Lord in his light, in the covered with light. And the light, Ezekiel 1, is like a rainbow, the many colors. And he gave Adam and Eve their image. There's my guy. And they gave him a uniform that matched the uniform of the Creator. Now, as soon as they sinned, the light went out. The coat went away. And they saw that they were naked. Now, how do you see something? They saw it with their eyes. The instant that they saw that they were naked, they gathered knowledge through their senses. They gathered knowledge through the five senses that they had, that their body had. Then they knew they were naked. They sowed. They saw it. They knew. They made a decision. They knew. They evaluated things based upon their body, what they saw their body doing. And then they sewed together fig leaves and made them. Where'd you get that idea? They made that up. They didn't go to God and ask him what to do. They said, we know what to do. We'll make some clothes out of fig leaves. How dumb could that have been? I don't know about you, but when you get dressed on Sunday morning to come to church, how many outfits do you put on before you come? One. It looks like it. Five aren't going to help him out any. But I bet that's not true of your wife. Most of us, he took three ties before I put that one on this morning. Now you probably wonder why I decided this one, because it looked different from all the others. But you make decisions. They didn't go to God to, you know, if they'd been godly, thinking God's way, and they'd made a mistake, where'd have been the first place you should have gone? They've been fellowshipping with him in the cool of the day. They've been conversing with him. Now I've made a mistake. Numbers chapter 30 talks about if a wife makes a mistake, her husband can come and do some certain things and vitiate the mistake. If Adam had been trusting God, when Eve took the fruit, instead of him taking it too, because he desired to be with her instead of God, he could have gone to God and said, Lord, we got a problem. What do we do? How do we fix it? But they didn't do that. They knew it all. They were wise in their own conceits. They had their own thinking process informed by the senses of their body and the desires of their flesh. They became completely dominated by their flesh. They became preoccupied with their body. They wanted to pamper their body. They wanted to follow the desires of their body. When he says over here in chapter 6, verse 12, let sin not therefore reign in your mortal body, your life is dominated as a lost person by your flesh, by your body. What its desires, its ability to calculate things and know things based upon its ability to perceive through your five senses and the reasoning that you have, the thought process that comes from that. He says, don't think that. Don't operate that way anymore. Because if you operate that way, sin is going to run your body, going to run your life. You're going to obey it. So first, you believe who God's made you. Second, you refuse to think like you used to think. You're going to think like God thinks. And you're going to take your mortal... You see, back here, as a lost person, you start thinking here in your body. It goes through your emotions, tells your soul what to think, and it pays no attention to what's in here, in your spirit. As a believer, he's put his life in here. The Word of God is spirit and life. He said, the words that I speak to you, they're spirit, they're life. And the mindset that it produces tells your soul how to make choices, takes your emotions and functions your body. For a believer, you function inside out. For the unbeliever, Adam and Eve, you function outside in. Know who you are in Christ. Believe it. That's why we talk about it so often. You need to know it. But then you have to believe it for it to make any impact in your life. Because when you believe it, therefore, you don't let sin run reign in your mortal body. You don't obey. You don't have a thinking process that says that's the right way to go. Now, the process of that is in verse 13. In verse 13, he's going to take your body, the mortal body, and he's going to talk about the members of your body, the pieces of your body. He's going to bring it down to the details of life. Neither yield your members as instruments, as tools of unrighteousness unto sin. You choose to not give the parts of your body to sin, to unrighteousness. You don't make available the parts of your body. Adam and Eve used their body parts to carry out their wise plan. They saw. They sowed. You know, when you sow, you got to use your hands. You got to use your eyes. You got to use your feet. They used their body in service of sin. The deeds. The flesh with the affections and lusts thereof. Galatians 5 talks about the works of the flesh. All the works of the flesh take some part of your physical anatomy, the senses of your, whether it's the sins of the spirit, the sins of the flesh, all takes part. Don't take all. Listen, in your life, the way you have a habit, your body of sin, it takes the parts of your body. It doesn't just, so it's not just, I'm not going to let my body, okay, you're not going to yield your mortal body. So what are the parts that in your life that lead you into sinful activity? Now you have to identify what it is. You can take Galatians 5 and get a long list of things. The things that come in our lives today that people, you know, that you are tempted with, faced with, and there are parts of your body that allow you to get into that. Back in Job 31, somebody asked me the other day about pornography. I said, the answer to pornography is in Job 31. He said, I made a covenant with my eyes not to look on a woman to lust after. I'm not going to let my eyes do that. So what do? You don't do it. That's a part of your body. Neither yield you your members as instruments, tools of unrighteousness unto sin. But here's the way you don't do it. Put off. One, put on, yield yourselves unto God. Choose to present your, as those that are alive from the dead, choose to present yourself, your spirit, your soul, and your body, the whole of you, to God as alive, as who you really are. As those whose know-it-all, self-sufficient attitude has been replaced by a new way of thinking, the sufficiency that you have in Christ. And your members, the pieces of you, as instruments of righteousness. I'm going to choose to be who I am in Christ, and then I'm going to choose to present my body, the members of my body, as tools of righteousness. I'm going to get busy with my eyes, my thinking, my emotion. I'm going to get busy with those as tools that produce righteousness unto God. Now, the way you present yourself, you know Romans 12. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice. That's Romans 6:3. A sacrifice died and is alive. You're a living, you've died, you're alive. You got newness of life. Present yourself as a living sacrifice. You're dead to sin, alive unto God. Holy. That's who you are. Acceptable unto God. That's who you are. And that's your reasonable service. That's the only way thinking the way God thinks produces life. And then be not conformed to this world. Be transformed. How? By the renewing of your mind. That's the process right there. So those five steps. Believing what God says is true. Choosing against the reigning of sin in your life. Choosing not to give your members to sin. Making those choices. Choosing to present yourself as alive unto God. And then the parts of your body as tools of righteousness. Now all of that demonstrates the necessity of temptations and difficulties in your life. And when you realize that, without a temptation, without a trial, without some suffering, these verses have nothing for you to be resistive of. You notice how much of it is resisting something. Because that's how you grow. The way you grow, the way you bring these things into the experience of your life, the way you get the application of your identity is you're in a situation where you need it. To appropriate something, first you need to know it. See, so he starts at knowing it. Then you need to believe it. It's a fact. You have to have faith in it. And when you have faith in the facts, it produces fruit. But if you don't have a need for the reality of who you are, there's no way to, you don't have where to use it. I've used the illustration many times about forgiveness. Ephesians chapter 3, verse 32. Be ye kind, tenderhearted, forgiving one another, as God for Christ's sake hath forgiven you. There's not a person in this room this morning that I can forgive. I cannot obey that verse in its fullness because there's nobody here this morning that I can forgive. You know why? Nobody's offended me yet. Don't go out the door and say, Brother Rick, I'm going to help your spiritual life and you grow. I'm going to offend you so you can forgive me. But do you understand, when you look at it the way God looks at it, and he says, you can forgive others like I've forgiven you. Not based on what they do, but based on who I am. Understand how Christ forgave me. But until you offend me, I can't do that. So when you offend me, I am free to choose to look at it and say, here's a problem that now gives me an opportunity to do something I could not previously do. And so now I can say, you know, instead of being mad at you, I can say, wow, thank you. Because now you've given me the privilege to do something I could not previously do. You follow that? I know you don't like it, but that's the thinking process. A problem, grace transforms it into an opportunity. But without the problem, you'd never have that transformation, that ability to grow in an understanding and an application of who you are into your experience. So the thing that brings these doctrines into our experience is the circumstances that allow us not to yield, but to yield, not to believe and to apply. So now problems are transformed into opportunities to experience what we otherwise couldn't do. Now, when you learn to think that way, that's not normal. Not the way your eyes and your desires or your flesh are going to think. If you're dominated, like Adam and Eve, by your body, preoccupation with the way your body operates, evaluates and thinks and feels and desires, if that's the way you're going to, your flesh, you'll never get this. But when your faith rests in who you are in Christ and realizes the liberty that you have to walk in this newness of life, now my life isn't just me being satisfied, now my life is an instrument of righteousness unto God. And I can present myself that way, and I can live as those that are alive from the dead. The problems become opportunities to experience in my life this new identity I have in Christ. So when you focus on the details of life, the life that I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. That's the way. That's where transformation in life comes. So in the passage, you're learning some truth, you're believing it, and then you're choosing to obey the commandments. It's the obedience of faith. And that's what verse 16 brings you to. Know you not that to whom you yield yourselves as servants to obey, and that's verse 12 and 13, his servants you are to whom you obey, well, the sin unto death, obedience unto righteousness. Who you choose to obey in your life, your practice, the habits of your life become what control your life, because they become the automatic thought response. As an unsaved person, sin controlled your thinking process. As a believer, you have a new life. And now by the renewing of your mind, by the rethinking God's way instead of the old way, it transforms your conduct. And it becomes the habit of your life. And then you do what Galatians, he says, be filled with the Spirit. Walk in the Spirit. Make progress through life, led by the Spirit. How you do that? Here's the Word of God, comes in here. I believe what God's Word says, and it works out through me. I work from in here out, from God's Word working through His Spirit out. The way the Spirit of God works in you, this is not magic. This is not something that just comes down and falls in the air, boom. This is the objective understanding of God's Word to you about who you are in Christ, your faith trusting it, and that faith enabling the Spirit of God to put it into practice in your life. The Word of God works effectually in you that believe. That word work there, the Greek word is, we get our word energy from. The thing that energizes the truth in your heart is your faith trusting it, and that's what puts it on display in your life. That's what transforms the details of your life, brings it into your experience. You make progress through life as a believer by making decisions, by taking actions based on what the Holy Spirit teaches you. Your faith application of the Word of God rightly divided. That's when verse 11, 12, 13, 14 of Romans, that's what it's about. That's the template. That's how you become fruitful unto every good work. And when he talks about walking in the Spirit, you won't fulfill the lust of the... didn't say they wouldn't be there. It said you won't do them. What are you going to do? Well, the fruit of the Spirit, love, joy. The fruit of the Spirit is what comes. The fruit of following the attitude, thinking process of what God's Word says, who God's Word says you are in Christ. That's where you become fruitful unto God. That's how you bring it into the details of your life. When we come back after next week, the Bible comes, I'm going to talk to you about the issue of temptation and try to go through some of these passages with you about how difficulties and trials really, instead of being burdens and things that ought to destroy you, even the deeply rooted sinful habits that come into your life, that are in your life, how God has set you free from those things, and how even those things are designed to be opportunities so that the life of Christ can live in you. And whether it's sins of the Spirit, attitudes, or sins of the flesh, physical things, we've been delivered from those things. And Paul says that our function as believers, we're to be perfecting holiness. We're to be perfecting who we are in Christ. And I want to talk to you a little bit about that, because that's really what fruitfulness is about. And it just simply starts with you knowing it, then you believing it. And then living by faith in the reality of the current, real identity God has given you in His Son. And looking at life and seeing anything that's unworthy of that and rejecting it. Being able to recognize what's unworthy, reject what's unworthy, and put in its place God's thinking. That's victory in Jesus. And we're not going to sing that as a closing song, but that's how you have it. Now, everything I've said this morning, if you're not saved, you don't really know Christ, you think it's religion, none of this is going to make any sense to you. If you don't know who you are in Christ, it ain't going to make much sense to you. If you're stuck in the, I got to do something to make God happy with me, rather than trust Christ and let what he's done be my life and live it in obedience to him. If you don't grasp that, that's where you need to go. Okay? All right. Praise the Lord. I could preach another 7 minutes because the kids aren't going to be out for seven more minutes. But I'll shame them by us getting out early, okay? Father, we thank you this morning for your love and your grace. We thank you for the life, the victory that you give us in your Son. And most of all, we thank you that we can say we love you because you first loved us. In Christ's name, amen. All right, we're going